Yeah, unbelievable freshman year. Set you up, I know, confidence-wise going into your second year, sophomore year. You know, you're the man. You ready to take that next step. Your preseason Naismith, you know, on the watch list, top power forward in the country. You got all the accolades. You end up having a great year. I mean, 13-8, I think, assists, two blocks. Probably, and this was my first year on staff, so it was a learning experience for me as well to you know, kind of be on the other side of things. But talented team, obviously, probably, you know, we could have done better as a team, but, you know, that's how it goes sometimes. But coming into that year for you, did you feel that pressure coming in? Like, knowing that, like, hey, I just had a great freshman campaign. You know, they're going to expect more from me. I'm going to have more on my shoulders. Like, did you feel that coming in? And, you know, talk about that second year a little bit.
I felt it when I first said, like, the words, I'm coming back. And, like, I have a video I posted on my Instagram as a little highlight tape, whatever, and the start of the video says, I'm coming back. And once I said that I was coming back was, like, the immediate – that was, like, the first time I felt the pressure, per se. And, like, for me, I was always good about, like, pushing that stuff to the side. So I felt it, like, right away in the off season. Like, for almost, I would say, if I would give it a timeline, maybe a week, 2 weeks, right? That was when all the articles were coming out that I'm coming back, all these different things were going on. And then, and shortly after that, it was like, all right, you know, it is what it is. Now I got to get to work. And so my thing was, and it still is, like, there's no amount of pressure that you're going to put on me or anyone else is going to put on me that's greater than what I'm going to put on myself.
Right.
You know, so for me, the toughest part about going into my second year was the amount of pressure that I did put on myself. Like, I knew that I was, quote unquote, the guy or going to be the guy of the team and all that stuff. And I think at times I probably put way too much on myself. Like, yes, I had a good second year. I had the 13-8, but, like, in reality, I feel like if I just went out and played my actual game of basketball half the time, I think I would have averaged 20-15. Like, I think that I just, at times, I put too much on myself and I expected too much of myself. And then, you know, it got really hard for me once freshman year, once people started to say, oh, you're a player. You know, because now I'm thinking, like, wow, I actually have a shot to reach my dream. Like, I wasn't worried about the money, none of that, but I was, like, we all want to be there. We all want to get drafted, all that stuff. So, like, it's always in the back of your mind. And so, for me, that was the first time I was like, you know, damn, I really am good enough to play in the league and be a first rounder. And people were saying I'm a lottery pick and all this stuff. And so, once I started to hear the NBA talk, like, then during games when, you know, we lost and I only had 10 points and 5 rebounds, now I'm like, shit, you know, we lost by 5 points. You know, if I had 15-10, now I look better for the scouts and this and that. So, like, I worried a little bit, probably too much, about all that extra stuff. You know, I still wanted, like, in the meantime and in the game, it would never cross my mind. But after the game, I was like, damn, I got, you know, those weren't the numbers I should have put up and this and that. And it affected me a little bit. And, like, so the beginning of my sophomore year was rough. Like, I started out, the season wasn't good. And, like, my first 4 games, I don't even know if I had to guess a number. I maybe averaged, like, 10-5, like, my first 5 games. But then once we got to ACC play, I, like, hit another level. And I remember my coach was talking to me, and I think at the time, I, like, through the first, like, 6 or 7 games, I was, like, one of the leading scorers in ACC and all this other stuff. And things kind of took care of itself that way. But it was a real struggle for me mentally, like, to start out that season with all those accolades and the pressure that I was putting on myself.
It can be a lot too. I mean, especially, absolutely, you know, like you said, bro, coming from where you're from, like, you're a small town kid, like, you don't ask for all that stuff. So, like, when all the, you at a big time school, high level, and all that kind of comes on you like that, it can be a lot for a kid. You was 19 years old. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. I definitely took it a little bit too hard, I think, you know, pressure wise. And then, and like you said, like, growing up in my small town, I was used to going to a game that had 500 people max in a gym, like, max. That was a sellout game, quote unquote sellout. The games are free, you know, like,
yeah, right.
People are coming out and driving their tractors to the gym. Like,
yeah,
that's just how it was. And so I'm not, you know, then all of a sudden you're playing Duke, 35,000 people, you know, and you're expected to be the guy playing against, you know, all that stuff. And I wanted that. I really did. I wanted that, and I expected it of myself, but I just put too much pressure on myself at some points, you know. And, like, I think that really caught up to me, and I finally learned once I got to the league and I was drafted, I finally learned that I got to be able to push that to the side and then go do my thing, sort of. So, you know, it was like a blessing in disguise. You learn a little bit from everything you go through, you know.
Absolutely. It's a part of your journey. And your journey is your journey. No one else's. You know what I mean?
No doubt.
Two games that really, I mean, you had a great season. Two games that stood out to me. The North Carolina game at North Carolina, we lost, but you killed. Yeah. I think you had 29-16 or something like that. And
yeah.
Mitch Kupchak was at the game.
Yeah.
I remember that. And then the play at Clemson. Take me through that play, because I forgot what Coach wrote up in the huddle, but you end up getting the ball up top, and it was kind of, you saw it, and then you ripped through with that drive.
Yeah.
Hit T in the corner, and he knocked out. Wow. So what was that? What was Drew
it
up
was,
right there?
It was the same exact play Villanova drew up to beat North Carolina for the championship the year before. Same exact thing.
For the handoff. It was supposed to be the handoff.
Yes. Okay. So that's all it was, right? It was a little pitch back, it was supposed to be for me. So it's supposed to be, I get my shot up top of the key, knock it down.
Yeah.
You know, so, like, right away, just you could see the way they were playing, there's no way I was going to get a shot. So the second I caught it, and, like, you know, being a good shooter, sometimes all it takes is a quick, like, get my eyes on the rim, and now I'm gone.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not even a pump fake, but it's just eyes to the rim. So I just looked at the rim quick. They kind of just stopped for a quick second. I knew I had a little edge on my guy, and I saw Tyus wide open in the corner, and I was like, it's all day. I'm passing it to him. I didn't care if he was a freshman, whatever. And big-time player, one of the best scorers, you know, in 3 years ever probably at Cuse. Like,
absolutely.
Big-time player. But, like, we all had trust in each other at that point, and I was passing it to him all day long.
Absolutely. The right play. You made the right play, the game-winning play.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, what a shot by him, but – man, those feelings, buzzer beater, stuff like that in college, you cannot beat it on the road. Oh,
on the road. And I remember I was right in the middle of that thing.
I saw the video the other day, and someone was like, he's more hyped up than anyone on the team. And you were like grabbing all of us. And all it was so funny.
that's that passion, that passion for the game.
Absolutely. You can't teach that anywhere.
No, that's a fact. So we'll talk about after your sophomore year, you decide to leave. What came into that decision, and you know, why did you end up leaving?
I mean, so I sat down with my family, and we kind of had a good little talk, you know. And I felt like even with the season that I had, which in my mind was a down year, and obviously from a team standpoint, we didn't perform as well as we wanted to, all those different things, but even with it being a down year, I still felt like I was ready, you know, like, and that for me was the only thing I needed to say that I'm going to get a chance to reach my goal. And so, like, I didn't care that people were saying, you know, oh, he's a early second round or a second round guy, a first round. I didn't care. My biggest thing was, I really felt ready for the league. Like, I stayed my 2 years. I added weight on. I expanded my game a little bit. I was more comfortable doing some things that I wasn't before. And so when I was talking with my parents, that, you know, we just kind of sat down and we were looking through our options and trying to figure some things out. And for the longest time, like, that was the first year that the NCAA came out with the whole, like, timeline of where you can come back and
– yeah.
And all that stuff. And for me, it was either I'm going or I'm not. I didn't care what the NCAA said, none of that stuff. It was either I'm ready and I'm going to the league, or I'm gonna take that head on, or I'm not. And so I sat down with them, and I really felt ready, and they believed in me. And so that's all it really took.
Yeah, I remember too. I was in the office that day when you came in with your parents, and I was like, yep, he going. I know it. Yeah. I knew it in my head. But it was like you said, bro, like, all you need. You don't need everybody else to believe in you. If you believe in you, like, the hard work that you put in, like, that's all you need. Like, because that's what you're going to have going forward. Everybody else who's saying something, they're not going to be with you.
That's it. And it was as simple as that. Like I seriously remember just being like, I really know I'm ready. You know, I made a call to, like, I talked to my high school coach here and there. And when I knew I was like going to decide that I was going, I talked to him a little bit and asked for some advice and some other stuff. But the biggest thing for me was like you just said, I don't care what anyone else says. It did not matter to me at that point. I was ready.
Absolutely. So tell me, what was it like, you know, playing for Coach B during your career? And then give me your favorite Coach Boeheim story, at locker room, after game, funny, whatever it is.
Yeah. I mean, Coach B's a legend, obviously. Yeah. There's everybody knows that. Anyone that's a college basketball fan knows that. Anyone that's a basketball fan knows that. But playing for him was like the first time you meet him. It's a surreal feeling. Even when you're getting coached by him in games, you know, my sophomore year, I'm like, I still couldn't believe that this dude is teaching me how to play the game of basketball and was my head coach and all those different things. I mean, my favorite story, man, I don't know. That's a tough one because, like, I feel like there's so many that are hilarious that you want to talk about. But then
one where he went off on T-Robe or something?
Oh, yeah. There's a million of when he went off on T-Robe. No, when he I actually have one of my favorite stories, and I was telling this the other day, and Caleb Joseph might get mad at me for telling this story. But anyways, it was actually the Gonzaga game. It was, like, I want to say it was late second half. Whatever happens, right? They come down, made a big play. We came down. And at some point, late second half, I made a big play that it wasn't the block. It wasn't anything like that. But I made a big play that was like diving on a loose ball or something. And Gonzaga called a timeout. And it was the first play I remember, though, that you could feel like the momentum start to shift in that game. We were like down 6-8 the whole game. And so I made a bigger play where I dove on a loose ball or something like that. And everyone's sprinting back to the huddle, fired up. And Caleb Joseph, I remember he just was so fired up. He punched me, like, hard as shit, right in my arm. And I was like, damn, you know, like, I'm, like, rubbing my arm. But Coach saw it. And Coach freaked out on Caleb. He, like, lost his – don't you punch him. What are you doing? And Caleb just, like, I was just excited, Coach, you know. But it was, like, the most – it was, like, out of pure joy that Caleb was so fired up. I mean, even in the moment, I was like laughing my ass off. I thought it was so funny, but Caleb kind of got the rough end of that stick, I guess.
Yeah, well, come on, man. He's not trying to risk any type of injury.
Right, yeah. That's the way he looked at it, though, which to me was hilarious because, like, I was going to shake it off. You know, I was like, damn, you know, and I was shaking it off and I was walking in the huddle and me and Caleb were dapping each other up, but that's not how Coach saw it. He wasn't taking any chances, I guess.